Thank you so much for coming, and I want to welcome you. So at this time, I ask that everybody stand. We're going to repeat the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we're going to ask our policemen to stand, all the policemen. Let's give them a round of applause. We can't thank them enough. Now, you may be seated. We're going to ask all the ministers in the house, either pastors or associate, to please stand. Let's give them a round. Now I'm going to ask all the public officials to stand. Let's give them a hand. We're so thankful for you being here this evening. We really appreciate it. He missed it. But anyway, one of my favorite scriptures is the 139th Psalm. And in that it said, we are fearfully and wonderfully made in God's sight. So that's my thing tonight. We're fearfully and wonderfully made in God's sight. So what I want you to repeat after me, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Praise God. At this time, I'm going to introduce the moderator for the evening. Let's give him a round of applause. Pastor Jay, the Rev. T. Phillips.
Well, welcome. We're so happy for you to be here today. And this just came out of a desire. We live in this community. We all love this community. And we've all been watching the news over the past months. And I'm sure all of our hearts have been troubled. And so what turns to our hearts is like, what is it that we can do in a positive way to see to it that our place is a place of love and of acceptance and of understanding? We have to have a place where we can talk and communicate. But more importantly, we need to be able to lead with a common purpose for a common good moving forward. We all have an investment in our community. And so tonight was an opportunity to come together, to use the church as a meeting place, and just to say that, to give us opportunities to speak and to share. Again, my encouragement, though, is around, we want to be solutions-oriented. We've heard enough of the talking points back and forth on TV, and what we want to say is, how can we work together and move forward? And to that end, I was on the internet and got a couple of videos that I think are positive examples of what some communities have done that have worked. And so to start off our time, I thought we'd just watch, just kind of get into the room and just watch the video, two videos. The first is one that is of an interview that was taking place, and then the second one is one that you probably saw from the Charleston. It's about forgiveness. And after that, I'll have a couple of comments, but then I want to open it up for conversation and for comments. And we'll do that at that time. Okay. So with that, hopefully this will work fine.
It was still just an emotion, and it was a total surprise to all of us who were out there. What you're about to see is people coming together to understand one another, to make their mark together.
See this face? A lot of people know it. Officer
finally got recognized.
Oh, he's awesome. He's very sweet.
Something else made me feel good, too, when someone else approached it at the 7-Eleven he goes to every day.
Jewish woman, African-American woman.
This encounter
would definitely impact the world, but it turned out of our own day.
Is why we originally came out to talk to him. It was the day after Dallas.
I got out of the car and she asked if she could pray. She prayed for me and offered around the country.
As he was telling that story,
I see him here all the time.
He was recognized again, this time by Caroline. And no one could have guessed what would happen next.
You're fine, man.
So with that, I just want to open up the opportunity for comments. I know some have been thinking and have things they want to say or have comments or questions. And so let's have dialogue. It's always difficult the first person to come. So you get an extra minute if you come forward to be the first one. But is there anyone that would like to start with any comments? Yes, Pastor Jim.
First, Jarrell, thank you for getting us together to put this on. We appreciate it. We need this. I want to say something to the civic leaders and to the police in our midst. And what I want to say to the local clergy person is simply this. Please use us. When you come across a youngster, a teenager, that they haven't crossed the line yet, but we can walk with them, use us. Use us as community advocates. Use us to reach out to them. Use us to mentor them. Simply use us. Because I've heard some beautiful stories as of late where leaders of faith, not trying to necessarily proselytize them in faith, but simply to be mentors to them, have been used around the country to change lives so that instead of ending up in prison, they end up in college. So what I want to say to you all is when you meet those people and you know what's going on in your communities, use the local clergy. Reach out to them that we can be mentors and hopefully change that trajectory around. So please, use us.
Someone else? Just raise your hand, we'll bring a mic up.
Hello, how are you doing? My name is Wes Ramsey. My wife's a pastor of Sunrise Baptist Church. I'll be 65 years old, so I've seen it all from the 60s on up. And what's going on today is, I'll be honest with you, it's now that it's back to where I think back in the 50s and 60s, where they have dogs on people now. So what they do to get around that, we'll make the dogs an officer. So when we put the dog on you, and you fight against the dog, we can shoot you now, because you assault the officer. And then we'll spend $1,000, bury the dog, meanwhile the family's struggling to bury their loved one. So what I'm saying is just, it's the same stuff that's happened in the 50s and 60s, but now it's been manipulated to make it look like, you know, you're threatening police officers. And look, we're not anti-police. You need police. If you don't have police, you have anarchy. You have anarchy and everybody. But if you speak up against bad policing, then, you know, you're militant or you don't like the police. And that's not true. That is not true. Black people want. We want law and order in our community. The ones who should be here, the thugs. The ones who are running around with guns, who killed that six-year-old girl, that's the ones who are not going to be here. They don't even go to church. They walk by the church, they'll break into the church to steal. But I'm saying that when a policeman arrives upon black people, and don't get me wrong, when there's been hard on blow charges been put on the ground, police officers off duty been put on the ground because they're black, clergy has been put on the ground and handcuffed because they're black. And it was a Republican representative said he's been stopped 7 times going into D.C. Now, he's a conservative, law-order Republican, but just because he's a black man. So what I'm saying is there's a lot of things that's still happening that shouldn't happen, but we are not, and believe me, we are not anti-police. You're crazy to be anti-police. But we know there's a wall, a blue wall, a little code of silence. If they do something, you can't, you know, the other police cannot step up and say, this is wrong, and we are going to testify against you. It's just not going to happen. So that's what my issue is as far as what's going on today. The thugs are not here. Yeah, there's thugs are ruining every community. They've ruined every community. They've ruined Monroeville. They've ruined East Hills. Homestead, where I live, they're ruining that too, running around with these guns. They need to be police. But when me and my wife's coming down the road, don't think you can stop us and try to treat and talk to us like, you know, we're subhuman because because of what these guys do. That's my issue. You know, treat us as law, you know, as fair and law-abiding citizens like everybody else.
May I say something? This meeting was, I feel the Lord had gave me the vision for this meeting, this evening, that we come together as one. And we're going to forget about the past now, and we want to move forward, and we want to move in oneness. That's the purpose of this meeting. Now, we have a community forum in October where you can come and voice your opinions. But let's keep it the way I feel the Lord would have us to do it tonight. How can we be brothers and sisters and love one another as we're commanded to do? That's the purpose of this meeting. And also to honor our policemen who goes out every day and put their life on the line. And that's the purpose of this particular meeting. Let's not forget that in your comments, please.
Just to summarize what you're saying, so there is a difference, and I think it is important because oftentimes in the media, media likes putting it's all or nothing on all sides, and so you're trying to say, it seems like to me, that there are those that need to be in jail or dealt with, and they should be dealt with. There is a place and a need for police officers, but there's also voices that are talking about us, and you're saying you're not with that. But let's find a way for us all to deal with each other with dignity and the same kind of respect. There was somebody else.
Yes. I want to say that I have a disability. So I'm the first person I called when I fall. First people I call to get me up off the floor are the police. I do need the police. I also need kindness and fair play. Now, when the police come, they're always kind of, I'm the threat to them. And I think that it's important to realize that when the police are a threat, it's hard for the police to be fair to us. And I think that we need to recognize that fairness needs to happen on both sides. The police need to be fair to us, and we need to be fair to the police. And that's what we have to do, is know that all of us need to be kind to one another.
So there's a need for understanding on both sides. Okay. Yes, Pastor Holman.
Yeah, I applaud that as well. My name is Harvey. This is my wife, Marlene, associate pastor in Pittsburgh. But I live in Bethel Park, and I used to live in South Park. And let me say something about the police. For one thing, I knew the police, and they knew me on a personal basis. In a former life, they gave me so many breaks. I mean, over and over and over, the personal relationship. And they seemed to look out for me and things like that. And even when I was acting up, that was my experience with police. And I live in Bethel Park, and they've been to my house many a time when my mom was living, like, you know, for ambulance service and other situations. And always polite and helpful. I just needed to say that. But the other thing is, parents, I should tell the young people a story. You know, growing up in South Park, in the Bethel area, you know, it was a different kind of a situation. I know the situation we have in the city and the police and the relationship there, but I'm speaking in terms of this community here. You know, tell you, those who are older, tell the young people a story. Tell the young men a story of your experience with the police, you know, and how much we do need the police. You know, and that all policemen are not, you know, out to get you at all. You know, we know the story about that as well. You know, it's the flip side. But not all police. You know, I ran into some nice men, I ran into some very ignorant and rude. You know, But we have to have a solution. So it takes both parties working together, you know, creating that solution. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm going to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Sharing our sympathy, Pastor.
Mayor.
Yes.
Mayor.
Thank you. I just want to say a couple things. People may or may not know, because I actually just read this the other day, that we have two of the safest communities in Pennsylvania right here. South Park is the second safest in the state for its size, and then Bethel Park is the seventh safest. So we're in safe communities. But that doesn't mean that something couldn't happen tonight anywhere. What I've been doing this summer is going to summer school classes that kids sign up for, and it's usually between kindergarten and second and third grade. And one thing that I do is after they ask me what I do, I talk to them about the police. Because I think that if you start at that young age, you can instill in their mind and their hearts that this is a good thing. Because if you don't, I had an officer come into my store, and one of the employees said, uh-oh, what, to my granddaughter, who's six. Said, oh, you know, look out, here come the police. We got up to the clerk and said, don't ever say that, because you're going to scare this little girl away from coming to you if they need your help. So I think that if we start them at a young age, in kindergarten to third grade young, but it certainly continues, we just have to let these kids know that the police are their friends. And that's what I tell them all summer. So that's all I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. That's good. That's
my name is Carl Benson. I think the right step that has been taken tonight is that you have both chief of police here from South Park and Bethel Park. And I think we're here to be more preventive. I think that's the key. You know, don't wait till a problem comes up and then we try to address it. And I think we know most of the times in your city or whatever, your problems, they're very, I mean, it's bad in the city, I'll put it that way. I know, from my work for Port Authority, I understood, seen a lot. But you look at what's happened in these last days, it's going to take us to work together and do things together.
That's right.
This is a step in the right direction here tonight. Y'all listen to me. I've seen a lot. I was raised in Bethel Park. I've been on a civil service commission close to 28 years. I interviewed a lot of police before they were even hired in Bethel Park. I've had hearings when police get suspended or whatever. Myself and two other commissioners are involved in it. But I think the main thing is now, let police know we care. That's what it's all about, see. Don't make them as enemies. They're not enemies. If we didn't have police walking here or being here in South Park and Bethel Park, you wouldn't be able to even go to the store or get out your car or go in the store and shop. I can remember back when I was a kid, I think Bethel at that time had about six police officers, six, maybe seven. And most of them was from 93, where I was raised. We knew everybody. You know, they all worked together. We had no problems back here. I think one of the biggest problems we had was when Joe, he was one of the police of Bethel, he got killed back in the 40s. I was a young kid and I remember that when he got shot. Ben Lynn Sutter was a very good friend of mine. But we need to realize one thing, we don't have to have that kind of a problem out here. You got clergy here, you got other Christians here, you got police here. We're here to work with everybody. I think that's the key. You know, you're going to have your problems, your difference of opinion about stuff. It's right, using the right approach. That's the key. The right approach. And the right approach is love. And letting people know that we care. You have a problem with a police officer, you got the chief of police in South Park back there. You have a problem in Bethel Park, you go see the chief of police at Bethel Park. That's what we need to do. If it's another police officer, if it's a county or a state or whatever, there's other means you can use to go and address it. So I think if we all think this way and do things the right way, we don't have the problem that you're having in other communities. We all know these are two good communities. South Park and Buffalo Park are two good communities for years. I mean, you had your arguments, your fights, and all that kind of stuff. That was minor. But what we all need to realize, we have to work together. So with our police, both South Park and Buffalo Park, let those police know we care. Thank you.
I'm going to say communication first and look for ways to communicate and support each other. And the mayor gave some good examples of how we can, when we see something being said, we have to be willing to speak up at the time to correct wrong thinking or wrong behavior, because we're all in this thing together. Yes?
Hi, my name is Pastor Marilyn Ramsey. What I would like to do, I'm all about solutions too.
All right, good.
And I thank the gentleman who said that he's going to classrooms, speaking, and please, when I grew up in school, they used to have where you can invite your peer and your career day and firemen and different things come in. But what I would like to see us do is go outside of our comfort zones, for the church to go outside the church, mm-hmm. and for us to do things collectively. If we're just sponsoring a basketball league, where people see us interacting, see us with you all outside of just formal events, mm-hmm. plan a picnic or something. We got this whole big park where the clergy, the community, the members, as well as police and firemen, all those that serve, that we can come to do things and do it as a community. Because I think when people see police officers and first responders is more than people who show up in a uniform. But these are men and women who are part of our neighborhoods and our community. And I think when we get back to being community oriented, I grew up, everybody knew their neighbors. People interacted with their neighbors. Whereas now it's more so people go to work, they come home, they stay with inside their four walls or with their little group. But I think as clergy and even lay people, if we get back to thinking as a community, that we are one, and we begin to do things in communities. When I grew up, communities blocked off whole streets and had block parties mm-hmm. and those type of things, that you were a true neighborhood community. And I think that if we get back to doing things like that, and we come together where we can collaborate and, you know, come up with ideas of how are we going to present ourselves as a community. And it's just not on the police officers. I know as clergy, we have a hard time getting people to come in the doors.
Yeah.
You come in some Sundays, if we all be true, so we're half empty or three quarters empty. And it's because even ourselves as believers in ministries are not out in the community. And I think that one way that we can come together and solve this problem, if we begin to become more evangelistic, which means we get out the lawns and we begin to operate like in the community like I grew up in. Because then people don't just see you as a uniform. They see you as their neighbor. They see you as the person who goes to their church. They see you as a father and a husband. And I think when we get to begin to look at each other like that and look at each other as love, a lot of even the miss how we perceive each other can be canceled out in our lives.
Thank you. Thank you. So getting out, joint activities. I know there's been some that have been going on. I remember growing up, there were many of those kinds of activities going on with the police pals and the basketball opportunities and things like that. And so those are all good. Our community days, maybe we can be more intentional about those. And coming out and taking advantage of a positive opportunity to come together. And modeling for the children, I heard that as well. It's so important that as parents, we are modeling respect, but we are also showing that respect for each other. Very good. So I like the solutions and ideas that have been put forth. Are there some more that, as others are thinking of, again, what are some ways we can talk together, communicate together? We have some of our officials as well. We'd love to hear from them. And and police officers as well. What are some ideas of how we can? Yeah, okay, we got Tim, and then we have.
I just want to really follow up with everybody. I think Tuesday is National Night Out.
Yes.
That's a good opportunity. The police are out in the community to do the neighborhood parks, or excuse me, the neighborhood block parties. And I think the role of an officer has changed over the years. It used to be law and order, but now, anytime something happens, they're there. The training they go through, they're the first responders, this is a medical emergency, things like that. So the role has changed. Maybe when you do see officers, normally it's when you're at a time of need. Maybe take some time if you see them, they're out in their community, their friends and neighbors. Go up and say hi, go up and thank them. You know, develop the relationships. I know over the last year with our chief, we've been out at, you know, events and meeting with the community and being more visible. And also being a friend and just talking to people. And if you see some things in your neighborhood that maybe you don't like to see, we talk about some of the element that were, you know, we're, things that are different or wrong, don't be afraid to call. Just let people know. You think we're only going to get better, our communities are going to get safer only if everybody gets involved. And we truly do need everybody's help and working together. But next time you see a police officer, go out and say hi and thank them and introduce yourself. I think the more we do that, the better the communication is going to be.
Thank you, Tim.
Thanks. I have a little different perspective on this thing. I look more in society in general, and I'm more concerned with the violence in our society in general and what's causing that to seemingly increase. And Black Lives Matter movement, I've thought a lot about that, trying to figure out what the heck is behind that and so forth. And to me, it's like, whatever the mayor of New York will say, well, all lives matter, like that justifies something, like, you know, I don't know what, but the fact of the matter is, I think we're trying to say that Black Lives Matter as much as white lives, or at least they should. And the fact of the matter is they don't, okay? Because you don't have police shooting white people, white kids all the time. You know, I know that that's not every policeman, and that's, I'm not sure what exactly all that's about, but, you know, there's more black people in jail than white people. There's more Flint, Michigan. If that was a middle-class community, you would never have lead contamination, okay? And if you're in L.A., corporation is not going to, you live in an upper-class neighborhood, they aren't going to dump toxic waste in your neighborhood, you're going to dump it in water. Okay? And people aren't stupid. and the whole thing is anger, as far as I can see. There's a lot of anger out there, and justifiably so. Okay? And as long as you have anger, you're going to have some people, a certain percentage, are going to get violent and try to express it violently. And the fact of the matter is, how much do I care? Okay, me as an individual, how much do I care? Alright? What am I? Am I supporting these companies that are doing all this stuff? Am I supporting companies that take their money and millions of dollars and put it overseas and offshore accounts instead of hiring poor black people, poor people, period, in this country that could be put in work? You know what I mean? We need to do something about that. We need to help them accountable. Okay? We want poor people to know we care. We need to hold these companies accountable.
Okay.
Don't invest in Wall Street for one thing.
Okay, so there are many issues, there are social issues, there's a lot of different ideas, Professor Jude here. And there's history that has to be acknowledged as well. But there is an answer in coming together. Yes, Jude.
I just want to go back for a second for the clergy here, and I can't speak towards Bethel Park and South Park. My dear sister from Sunrise said, in September comes up the South Park Community Day, and I wonder what it would be like for all the churches to be together there and to have you know, a row of tables where all the churches are gathered to say, as people walk by, we're the Church of South Park.
Yes.
It doesn't matter which particular church, but we're there together in ministry together, and we have that united front. And so I just say that to the churches, because it's coming up in September, and I think it'd be awesome for all of us to be there together. So
that's great. Thank you. We have AM Honors going to be happening up in Parkford, and so it'd be great if we could talk to the police about that, and we can do some things together there. Those are all opportunities for us to work together. I've had the unique opportunity as well to be a paramedic, and so I was a paramedic for a number of years. I worked in the city. I worked for Merck's and Castle Channel, Mount Lebanon, and also with in Bethel Park, and so. Being part of that first responder force, I've been there and been in the front lines. And so it is important that we realize and recognize that order is something that is to our benefit as a society. And there are times where there are individuals that respond with power in different ways, and even wrong ways, but because of one person, that doesn't justify the whole group being cast in a certain way. And the same thing is what our brother was saying here. The other side is true. There can be some thugs, some people in a community acting a certain way, but that doesn't mean that all are like that. And so by having conversation and communication, we can help to kind of break down those stereotypes. Yes. Yes. We'd love to hear from our chiefs, one of our chiefs.
Yes. Good evening. And if you didn't know this, overnight out in San Diego, there were two officers. They pulled a car over, and both of them were shot. One's dead, and one went to surgery today. And the one that died was the 33rd police officer in America that was shot and killed this year, since the first year. And we're not even through July yet. So I'm going to ask the clergy, please remember him, you know, in your services over the weekend. Everybody keep their families in your thoughts and prayers. And hope the one that survived, that he makes a full recovery. Thank you.
Hi. I've only lived here in this area for the past year and a few months. I'm originally from McKeesport, and I grew up in the McKeesport area. My church is in McKeesport, and my other church is in Homestead. And these are two cities that devastate me at times, because I'm right in the middle of gangs and everything else. But I belong to a ministerial in the McKeesport area, and it has been, in the last 2 months, wonderful to be with our mayor and our policemen. We've been able to sit together and talk together as clergy and laity, and our political parties together, and hear what they have to say. Because we can sit back and we can say what we want to say and what we surmise, but they're the ones that are really out there. And I know where my one church is. We just rebuilt a beautiful playground that the state helped us fund with basketball courts, and they had to take the basketball courts down. And when I asked the mayor what really happened, and he had to share with me that our kids up in our neighborhood cannot do this because of the people way down in the city that are coming up, the gangs. And it's not just blacks, it's not just whites, it's both of them together. And this is what, when we asked the policemen what they needed, they said, we need prayer. We need lots of prayer. And when you see us, don't be afraid to stop and pray for us. And so what we did, we have invited our policemen in on Sunday mornings. If you're around our church, stop in. We will stop what we are doing and pray for you. And what Pastor Judd had said, we have International Village in the McKeesport area every year. Our churches have got together. And we have a booth there every year of all our pastors taking turns, a couple hours here, a couple hours there, passing out tracts, praying for our policemen, praying for our city, praying for each other. And we do that every single year. And James don't know, but I just signed him up for 4 hours. And we get our And what you can do for us is, you know, you're there, and let us pray for you. Let us be embodied you, that we know that God's going to take care of all things. And to do this in this community is awesome, because we need to see what God is going to do in this area. I always believe when you have a church a little bit up on the hill, the scripture says the city on the hill is not dead. This place is not dead. It's just the beginning. This city, this township is not dead. There's a lot of great things happening here, and I'm proud to be here now and see what God's doing in this area. Thank you.
Good dialogue with anyone else? I have some more comments, ideas, suggestions. We have a couple in the back. One who has the microphones. In the back there.
I just wanted to piggyback off of something that I heard someone say earlier about the police pile program. My kids actually went to school in Bethel Park before we moved away, and one of the programs for the police pals, and I know they're coming to the school at different times and all different activities throughout the course of the year, so the kids begin to kind of develop a relationship with the police and interaction with the police, so it wasn't only a time they were beating them, was out in the street when something bad was happening, but it already became comfortable with being around them. So my question is, and trying to get you guys involved a little bit, are those programs still going on now? And if so, what do you think from a community standpoint we can do to help further those type of programs or anything that we can do to kind of help in that area?
And can we get a response from South Park and Memphis Park? Like, are there community?
Yes, there are. Yeah. Yes. We continue. We have our Citizens Police Academy. We have.
Is there a microphone?
We have our students enrolled in that,
okay.
And we have various programs throughout the year. We keep in touch with the kids. We have a school resource officer. We have a crime prevention officer, and we're always doing something with the kids. And we work closely with Officer Modrak from Bethel Park School District. So yes and yes, that would be the answer to that. And I mean, what you can do is, as a community, you can always direct kids to us if they have a problem, and we'll try and work with them and get them pointed in the right direction, or let them know to contact us and we'll plug them in. And we'll be out actually Tuesday night for National Night Out. We're going to probably go around Bethel Park, and we're going to be handing candy out, trying to meet the kids, talk to them, and interact with them.
Okay.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I have a follow-up question real quick?
Yeah. So,
is there any programs where kids can actually come up to the police station and just kind of hang out, interact with you guys, see what you guys do? Maybe, you know, younger kids get interested in becoming police, and they can come over.
The question was, are there any programs where kids can actually come to the police station, interact with officers there, et cetera?
Yeah, we do. Well, our crime prevention officer, she has kids coming through all the time, meeting the officers, taking tours, seeing what they do. So we do that throughout the year. And again, you contact us if somebody wants to come up and meet us and have a tour, we'll set it up.
Okay.
Okay?
Sounds good. Thank you.
South Park too, or just Beth Park?
South Park also.
Okay.
I just also wanted to mention that in addition to the programs that the chief mentioned, we also have a pretty significant crime watch program that we've developed with all of the people in Bethel Park, where we meet on a regular basis, the police department does. And that's part of a reflection of the fact that the police work requires them to rely on the people in the community to be working with them, to be part of the eyes. And the more we get people engaged in that, then not only is the enforcement better, but there's that better relationship with the police department, because now you've recruited people directly into the effort with the police department. So I think we now have something like 1,000 people signed up to the Crime Watch program. They don't come to every meeting, but they're there and they do on a rotating basis attend. And it's a great opportunity for our police department to communicate directly with the people. But lastly, I just wanted to say, as I was sitting here, I want to commend you people for taking this step. And my reaction is it would have been very easy, I think, for people to just sort of be cynical and stay cynical and just ignore this instead of saying, let's do something positive instead of negative. Because what happens, I think, is when we see what happens just on the news, it's the anger and it's the frustration that gets the expression. That's what it looks like. It looks like hatred and anger gets the expression. But you've got to counter that with things like this, where the expression is the community and the understanding. And visibility for that. You need to have the visibility. So a lot of the things we've talked about tonight are aimed at making it visible for people to see that the community and the police work together. And we, as public officials, are very open to any and all ideas that you can bring to us to do that. So, but I want to commend you for taking this step, because I think it's a great anecdote to what we've been seeing on a regular basis. So, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I just want to say, before I leave, to the police, that we're not anti-police. And I apologize that you guys think we're, because we're not. We need you guys. We really do. It pains me in my community that in Kingwood we have Italian Day, Hispanic Day, Slow Walk Survey. Guess what day we can't have because of the gangs and the thugs? We can't have African American Day. It's gone. It's been gone for about 10 years. And that pains a lot of people, but you can't do it. So there is a problem in that community. Do they need police? Absolutely they need police. But I want to say, on August 13th at the community house, we are having a church picnic, and you guys can stop if you want to get in the plate. Stop and meet the people. There's a lot of people coming. It's August 13th at the community house for the police. We need you guys. I just want to let you know that we appreciate you guys.
I'd like to say, Bethel Park has, as you mentioned already, police pals, which do a fantastic job. In fact, they have been supporting our food bank for years. And my question is, I wonder if South Park policemen can have such a program as Bethel Park Police Pals. They also have basketball games and these type of things. And I think that will break down some of the issues.
Awesome. Well,
we still already have a lot of programs similar to what Bethel Park runs. Our kids are, we live in the community. My officers have kids in that school district. We're there every day. Every day, we interact with the kids. And where the plus comes in with that, it's like when the rest of us went to school, if you saw a marked car in uniform pulling up in front of the school, what'd you automatically think? Something bad is happening, right? Now these kids, they see Officer Bill, Officer Tony, Officer Dennis, Officer whatever. It is so commonplace and so normal. And that's what we're trying to achieve, and that's what we continue to achieve. I just got a phone call today from the football team. They're doing team photos next week. Well, they want to put a fire truck and a police car and all that in their football team photo. Mm-hmm. You bet we're going to be there for that. It's a process that you have to go and get the police departments out in the field. At the same time, we need, like we're doing right now, have the people go and talk to us. Okay. I don't sit in my office with a crystal ball trying to figure out everything that's going on. I work on information. I collect information. That's what I do. So, as long as you call us, we respond to it. You see us out in the street, we respond, talk, meet and greets, whatever. And law enforcement is going through a little tough time right now. It'll pass. It always does. I remember the 60s also. It passes. And then we just try to do a better job. We're just trying to do a better job for the communities that we serve. I was born and raised in this town. So I'm just part of it. Everybody had a chance to throw me out 100 years ago. That's what we all do. Probably what's missing here tonight, to be honest with you. Where's the media at? I saw the one girl from the newspaper, from print media, she's here. Yeah. They have on TV all the time about people getting shot at and that there's bullets flying in this street and that street and all that, and the media rushes down there with their cameras.
But you are right. And it's a good exercise. I did it in preparation for this. Like you said, there is so much negativity out there. And you can go on the internet and you can see all these, you know, the worst of the worst recorded on there. But if you put in there positive police action or positive videos, there are scores of stories, like the one that the audio was a little off tonight, but scores of stories of black and white communities, Hispanic communities, working together with police officers and where kids are playing with police officers and all these heroic acts that are happening on a regular basis. And it's important for us because if the media is not doing it, we need to do it. We need to be letting people know there's another side of the story. There's another side of this in the community. And so we take responsibility for being that voice, a positive voice. So we're almost wrapping up here. I do know we do have a, yes, Representative Sir Cohn. Yes, right here, please.
Thank you. I just want to add one or two things sitting here listening. And thanks for inviting me. I'm really happy to be here. These community events are great, and it is what we need. But I think, I just want to get back to a more broader, basic problem. And I know you all know this. Oh, I need some feedback. So do I have to move to get rid of that? Okay. There's a more basic problem. I mean, I know you all know this when you see it, but we live in a violent, rebellious culture right now. Our culture is crashing down around us, folks. And we're sitting here shaking our heads thinking, what do we do? What do we do? You know, our kids are growing up where profanity and vulgarity and disrespect for authority and disrespect for the law is commonplace. That's what they're being taught. And that's what we have to counter. We all, for many of us in this room, we know the answer to that is right here. And that's why we're doing this in a church. And for many of the clergy sitting here, that's great. I hear the answer. We got to get out there. The clergy has to work with the government. A lot of people are afraid to do that. And I hear it from clergy as I go around, as I try to reach out as a government official. They're afraid to work with the government. Because you've been told there's a separation of church and state, which is nonsense. But they're afraid. The government is trying to work with you. And you've got to work with your government. We've got to work together to get this done. And I do ride-alongs with our police. I've done, I have 12 municipalities in my legislative district, and I've ridden with all of them, and I'm going to do it again. When I finish that route, I go back and start over and start riding along with them. Our police officers, especially in these communities, very professional. You are very fortunate, the police you have and the leadership that you have in our police departments here, compared to some other communities. I get to see policing around this state, and I'm telling you, it's different, and the communities are different. You're blessed to be in a community like this. Yeah. Remember, our police are professional, but they're also human. Yeah. And when you just put yourself in their position for a minute. I'm a former law enforcement officer myself. When you go up to a car, or you go up to an incident, the first thing they're thinking of is there a threat there to me? I want to go home tonight safely. I want to solve this problem, but I also want to go home tonight and see my family. And their reaction might be dependent largely on the reaction that they get when they walk up to your car. If they get an attitude, they're going to be, okay, I may be in a threat situation. If they get a different type of reaction, then they're going to react differently because they're human beings. And we have to understand that. When we teach our young people to be disrespectful and to counter authority, then we're setting ourselves up for failure. So, We've got to counter that. We've got to work on that. I'm a firm believer in community policing. I'm a firm believer in we get out. And we do. Our police are out there at events. But you're right. We need to be out there more. All of us. Government officials, police need to be out there. And you all need to be out there. Church members, clergy, all of them. Showing that love that I heard over there. That's good. We need to show that love. We know what that love is. Everyone wants to be treated well. Everyone wants to feel like they're important. And they are. All citizens should be treated well. So we've got to do our part. Let the government work with the government to do their part. Don't be afraid to call on us and work with us. I saw that lady praying with that police officer. God bless her. That's a great thing. And you shouldn't be afraid to do that. You should never be afraid to do that. So reach out. And this is a great start. And I hope we'll keep it up. And thank you very much. And God bless you. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Just a couple more. Over here. Oh, just a couple more. Yes. Yes.
I would like to ask a follow-up question. Our representative here or our police. And the representative said something very crucial to me as a mother of an African American. should anyone react when they're stopped by the police to minimize any type of threat?
All right, that's very good. And I'm going to tell you, the police are trained, okay? And when they approach the car, they're looking for certain things. So if you're ever stopped by the police, or you have relatives that are, you think are going to be stopped by the police, the most important thing they can do is cooperate. The officer's going to give them verbal instructions. Follow the verbal instructions. And if you do that, you cooperate and follow the verbal instructions, you're going to avoid a tragedy happening to the officer or the person in the car. So that's the best point, the piece of advice I can give you. And you convey that back to your family, your friends. If you're stopped by the police, cooperate. And you're going to walk away. You may have a ticket. If you feel you're wronged in the stop or you got the ticket wrong, you can go in front of a judge. You can make a formal complaint against the officer, but you'll be alive. Okay? Like the representative says, officers walking up the car, they don't know who's in there. They want to go home, and they don't know who's in there, and everybody's a potential threat until they come and interact and establish that they're not a threat. So that's the best thing you can do is just cooperate. Whatever the officer tells you to do, comply with it. Chances are you're going to go on your merry way very shortly thereafter. Okay?
All right, thank you very much. Any last comments before we have a few presentations to make, but yes.
And so it's okay to be angry. People get angry, but the Bible says, anger but sin not. You don't have a right to get angry and take somebody's life. I don't care how angry, and I just think we as clergy have to do a better job at getting outside the four walls and dealing with people. Somebody come to you and they tell you they're angry and they don't like this, but we have to turn that around with a soft response. The Bible said a soft response turns away wrath, keeps things, and even if you're stopped and somebody approaches you, even if you think the cop's not talking to you the right way, a soft answer turns away wrath. So we have to be responsible, we have to teach our people, we have to get outside the walls. When I look at what the problem is, I'm not looking at the police. And I would like to get the congressman or whatever representative's information. I'm willing to work with the government. Because the thing is, it's not the problem isn't the police officers. The problem is the church. We fell asleep. That's why they have all these other voices. That's why people can tell them they don't have to be disrespectful, because we got comfortable within our four walls, and we got to rise up, and we got to raise our voices. We got to go in places that we don't want to go and deal with people that we wouldn't normally interact, and we have to make the voice of the Spirit of the Lord louder than the voices of the enemy that are going across the airwaves. So if the finger should be pointed anywhere, it shouldn't be pointed at the police officers. It should be pointed at those who call on the name of Jesus and say that we are called, because our greatest call is to go out and make disciples, not just out of men. The Bible says nations. And we can't do that staying where we are. So I know you're going to close, but I know you being who you are, that we could close in prayer, I hope. And the first thing is, we who were to carry the message of love and forgiveness and tolerance, we need to repent. And then after we repent, then we can, this is just me, how the Lord's leading, you may have something different. Then we can go and offer prayer to these officers. But we need to start where judgment starts, and that's in the house of the Lord. And we have to do better.
As moderator, I don't get a chance to give much comment, but I'll take advantage of the one moment to do that. And what I've seen is that the answer is a spiritual answer. And Sharon and I had an opportunity to go to South Africa, and we were very much impacted by
going through Mandela's prison. And one of the things that struck me, the person who was our guide was in prison with Mandela. And he was sharing his experience there. And he said, he asked us, why is Mandela a great man? And we all said different things. And he said it came down to two things, but the one thing he said was reconciliation. And he says, now reconciliation means something different for us than it does for you in the U.S., which kind of struck me because I've spent a life of reconciliation working for Promise Keepers at other places. So I was like, well, how is it different? And he says, for us, we define reconciliation as the ability to not retaliate. And it really sunk deep. And he began to share stories there of how they were mistreated in that prison. And even after being mistreated, they would ask the guards about their families and their children. And you know, when Mandela became the president, he had the clerk come and serve beside him. And there's something about the power of forgiveness. That even when we start talking about historic problems and injustices, we can get stuck in this thing of bitterness. And there's a point that we have to say, yeah, there's evil that happens. There's evil that happened before. But it begins with each of us. As the scripture talks about the priests, they each had to carry first their own pain, understood that they had their own sins. And as they came before God, they got forgiveness for their own sins. And then they could come on behalf of the people. And we have to realize that all of us, we carry our own baggage. So as we are set free, then he gives us the power to then share that with others. We are then healed enough to carry healing to others. And so I hope that this has been productive for everyone. I think this was a good beginning. I'd like to just reiterate something that my brother, Pastor Jude, said at the very beginning, and that is that as clergy, we are offering our services. Many times we can be a moderator, we can be a translator, we are in the community, and so please use us. I don't know what the chaplaincy programs are or other ways, but we're saying, please use us. Help. We want to help, whether it's in the schools or in the communities. Sometimes we can help to be that go-between. And with that, we also wanted to make sure that we took an opportunity to just honor the two police departments. As we were saying, we are blessed to live in these two communities. And these are safe communities, and it's because of a lot of the work that's been done despite all of the problems for that to happen. And so with that, can you have that too?
We asked all the police want to go to the front.
Yeah, if the police officers could come to the front, and we would like to make a presentation to the chief of police. So we have here one for Bethel Park and one for South Park, and it says Commitment to Excellence Award presented to Bethel Park Police Department and South Park Police Department. It says, in recognition for your dedicated service to the community, presented by the Bethel Park community and South Park community and Shiloh Church, July 29th, 2016. So thank you both for that. She has a presentation as well, or properly. Ellen, County Councilman is here.
Come here. Welcome.
Okay, come here. Welcome.
Thank you. Justice for us allowing me to challenge people. Thank you. It's such an honor to be here today. I mean, God is so good, and God is so powerful, and we need to recognize that power, and that's why I kept hearing prayer tonight. digest stuff, and I want to remind everyone too, tomorrow is the 60th anniversary of our national motto, In God We Trust. And that's where we need to turn our eyes, and that we have allowed a very small, very loud, vocal minority to push God away out of our schools, off of our buildings, and we need to reclaim our Christian heritage and proclaim, like Representative Sutcombe said, there is a God, and He hears our prayers. And if we're Christians, we need to say, yes, we know there's a God, and go and pray with someone when we see them in need. And I love the idea. You're going to see me embracing police all over Allegheny County. Anyway, so let me get to the proclamation. And it's an honor to be here on behalf of Allegheny County Council. My name is Sue Means, and I represent Bethel Park. And this is Councilman John Paul Merrick, and he represents South Park and more beyond. Whereas on Friday, July 29th, 2016, during the Shiloh Church Town Hall meeting, the Bethel Park Police Department will be presented with a Commitment to Excellence Award in recognition to their dedicated service to Bethel Park Community and Shiloh Church. Whereas recognizing the changing and diverse needs of the community, the Bethel Park Police Department promotes, encourages a policy of professional and individual excellence, which is delivered and enhanced by continuing education and training. Whereas, in addition to enforcement and prevention, the Bethel Park Police Department is a proud partner and supporter of the number of community initiatives and events. Whereas, the members of the Bethel Park Police Department work with great dedication, courage, and unselfish resolve to protect and serve the citizens of Bethel Park with an unwavering commitment to public safety. Whereas the citizens of Bethel Park and the congregation of Shiloh Church are grateful for the Bethel Park Police Department's exemplary accomplishments in the field of law enforcement and public safety. Now, therefore, let it be resolved that Allegheny County Council, on behalf of all those who live, work, and play in Bethel Park, we express our appreciation and recognize the efforts of Bethel Park Police Department and thank the department for their steadfast commitment to outstanding service. And this proclamation is sponsored by all the members of County Council, Sue Means, John Paul Merrick, John DeFazio, and Sam DeMarco. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I had my first miracle the day I found this place. I was wandering around out there like the Jews in the desert. I could have been out there for 40 years. I tell you, some really nice person said, "You want to go over here instead of over there." So I just want to say I'm really appreciative of the invitation. I've been invited to come here a few times on Saturday. I'm a bar. Okay, even though I'm on County Council, I have to make a living. Saturday's my day, and I have a hard time. I had a difficult time trying to get out of here tonight, but I wanted to get here because I thought this was significant. But the community's coming together, and particularly to honor and to show our appreciation for our police departments. Whether they're county police, state police, local police, it's very important for us to support them all the way down the line. And I also want to tell you, I grew up in a city. I grew up in a very mixed neighborhood. We had all ethnic groups on there. But the one common theme that we grew up with was we respected authority. We were taught from the very beginning, if you're approached by a person of authority, you show your respect and you listen. You don't just hear, but you actually listen. And we did that, and it held us in good stead for a long time. In our neighborhoods, we never had problems, we never had racial problems or anything like that, because we were all taught the same principles, the same values. Whether it was in a Catholic church, a Protestant church, a German church, a Italian church, all the preachers and priests all taught us, and our parents really reinforced what we were taught in the churches. So I'm really honored to be here tonight. And I want to read this proclamation here for, excuse me. I represent South Park and all the way out to Elizabeth Pearl. Okay, all the way out Route 51. I have 96,000 people and I get a lot of emails. I'm going to read the proclamation if you don't mind. Whereas on Friday, July 29th, 2016, during a Shiloh Church Town Hall meeting, the South Park Police Department will be presented with the Commitment of Excellence Award in recognition of their dedicated service to the South Park community and the Shiloh Church. And whereas recognizing the changing and diverse needs of the community, the South Park Police Department promotes and encourages a policy of professional and individual excellence, which is delivered and enhanced by continuing education and training. And whereas, in addition to enforcement and prevention, the South Park Police Department is a proud partner and supporter of a number of community initiatives, which you heard them allude to earlier. Whereas the members of the South Park Police Department work with great dedication, courage, and unselfish resolve to protect and serve the citizens of South Park Township with an unwavering commitment to public safety. And whereas the citizens of South Park Township and the congregation of Shiloh Church are grateful for the South Park Police Department's exemplary accomplishments in the field of law enforcement and public safety. Now, therefore, be resolved that Allegheny County Council, on behalf of those who live, work, and play in South Park, we express our appreciation and recognize the efforts of South Park Police Department and thank the department for their steadfast commitment and outstanding service, sponsored by myself and county, most of our county council, who really endorse all of this also. So I'm really proud to be here, and I thank you very much.
Thank you. In Jesus' name.